Romans 5, 1 through 5. The result is this: since we've been declared in the right on the basis of faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus, the Messiah. Through him, we've been allowed to approach, by faith, into this grace in which we stand, and we celebrate the hope of the glory of God. That's not all. We also celebrate in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces patience, patience produces a well-formed character, and a character like that produces hope. Hope, in its turn, does not make us ashamed, because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. Romans 8, verses 26 to 28. In the same way, too, the Spirit comes alongside and helps us in our weakness. We don't know what to pray for as we ought to, but that same Spirit pleads on our behalf with groanings too deep for words. And the searcher of hearts knows what the Spirit is thinking, because the Spirit pleads for God's people according to God's will. We know, in fact, that God works all things together for good to those who love him, who are called according to his purpose. Amen.
I'm not used to sitting down, but there's no pulpit to stand behind. Not that I ever really stand behind the pulpit that much anyways, but... All right. Thank you, Sherry Ann. So this morning, again, this is Trinity Sunday, and welcome to Trinity Sunday. So we're going to talk a little bit about the Trinity this morning, but we're going to talk more about how the Trinity affects our lives, or how God walks with us through our lives on that journey that Peter Helms was speaking about. And the Trinity is actually one of the most fascinating and controversial Christian dogmas. The Trinity is a mystery. And by mystery, the church does not mean a riddle, but rather the Trinity is a reality above our human comprehension, that we may begin to grasp, but ultimately must know through worship, symbol, and faith. And it has been said that mystery is not a wall to run up against, but an ocean to swim in. An ocean to swim in. So this morning, how are we doing? Go ahead, bring it up. So this looks ominous up here, I'm sure. But 3 plus 1 equals 2, the uncommon core. It's a little play on common core mathematics there. Whether you're into it or not, that's neither here nor there. But this is the 3 plus 1 equals 2, the uncommon core. So this looks pretty amazing. This is the... format that has been put together through the years. And St. Anselm has been credited with kind of formulating this idea of the Trinity, or the triune God. However, even 500 years before him, Gregory and his brother Basil and their friend Gregory, so this is Basil, Gregory, and Gregory, they saw in the Bible many passages that seemed to refer to a multiplicity in a one God. And so they extrapolated from there. And this is the wonderful thing that's symbol that has been put together. So you see in the middle God, that God is the Father, God is the Son, God is the Holy Spirit, but the Father is not the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit is not the Son, and the Son is not the Father, yet they are three in one. And that therein is the mystery. I've heard a lot of people try to describe what this is like, and some people try to use the term like, you know, say, Maynard, you're a Father, you're a Son, and you're a Comforter. However, you really can't use that analogy, because at some point throughout your life, there could become some disunity between some of those roles. So that really doesn't really adequately express the Trinity. So, but we're not going to get into a huge theological dialogue this morning. I just want to use this as a little bit of background. And we find this actually expressed in the Nicene Creed. And we've heard of the Nicene Creed. We know the Nicene Creed. We believe in the one God, the Father, the Almighty, all of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, and the only Son of God. So we're, most of us are pretty familiar with this and what it says. And I'm not going to read through all of this, but I love the fact that when we began this journey with this church, I won't say that I had a crisis of faith, but I felt like I was getting to that because so many things were changing. The direction that I had always believed, you know, that was sort of my foundation. And now if all of that is being challenged, where do I go from here? And then I remember that one day when we were sitting in service and it just finally clicked that my anchor, if my anchor is the creed, then everything else I can discuss. And I am so good with that now. I'm like, okay, settled down, relaxed. Well, sometimes. You see how I get every now and again here. I'm still challenged, but I'm still growing. But it's a journey. And it's a journey that the Holy Spirit continually partners with me and the Father and the Son. And so the Trinity actually, it encourages my faith that this amazing God in all his glory would choose, because he chose first, would choose to walk this journey with me and give me the opportunity to include him in my life without overtaking everything. And so today I really want to kind of focus on that, keeping in mind in the Nicene Creed here, it never does speak about God's sovereignty over every aspect of our lives. I don't really see in scriptures where we see that he has his fingers in every aspect. I believe he's there with us all the time through everything, but how can he possibly control everything? Because this is one of the terms we hear, God is in control. How in control can God really be with so many individual wills? Right. How in control can he actually be? And that's a challenge sometimes to people's faith that, you know, oh, you can't go there. You can't take me there because, you know, I just want to believe that God is in control of everything. Well, that's a nice thought, I believe. Some people, you know, in their prayers, things are happening in their lives and they want God to just, boom, it's all better now. But I think that goes against God's character. Because he will never overtake man's will. And with every decision we make in life, as we go through this journey, I think if he snapped his fingers like that, he's interjecting his will into man's will and violating his own character. So this is the challenge. You know, we just want to be, oh, God, just fix it all, fix it all, fix it all. I think it's more of a partnership. And I think sometimes we do a big disservice to new Christians, baby Christians. And baby Christians can be people who have followed Christ for 40 years or followed him for 40 minutes or even 40 seconds. But I think some believe that our view that God is so has his hands into everything harms a lot of people. I'm not sure if it, you know, to what extent, but I think we do a disservice many times when we use some of these offhanded expressions that we're going to cover, like, if God wills it. Okay, well, I'll see you next Friday if God wills it. What's that mean? You know, I've always wanted to ask somebody that, but, you know, some people would maybe get a little offended, but I'm just, if God wills it, well, would he will it otherwise? So, you know, if God forbid some, you know, here we go again, if God forbid some tragedy would occur, you're ascribing that tragedy to God's will? We really have to be careful. And I think this is where we get a lot of people these days who, I just can't believe in that kind of God. I just cannot believe in that kind of God. I refuse to believe in that kind of God that's in so much control that he's moving the pieces around on a chessboard. Much like the early Greeks and the Romans believed about their many gods. You know, they're just sitting up there, just moving the pieces around and making people do what they want them to do. But it doesn't make sense. And has anybody, did anybody watch Jessica Kelly's interview with Russ? And I know some of you actually read the book. This kind of, when that came out, I was already stirring in my heart about what I was going to share this morning. When that came out, I was like, that's it. This is it. I mean, it's really got me thinking and really kind of forced me to start wrestling with things a little bit more about this, what she refers to, or Russ was referring to, as this blueprint worldview, that God is right down the line, that it's all this way, and he's got his fingers in everything. And I just can't bring myself to that point, because I think in my mind, in my life, it seems that something is still missing if I believe that. And she spoke about that. She spoke about that passion. You know, we can believe that, and it's that God's fingers are in everything, but then sometimes we get to that point where, okay, great. So what? And we'll get into that a little bit more in a moment. But Romans 5:1-5, and you're going to see a little bit of a difference in the translations than what Sherry read. And that's okay. It's good to see different things from different perspectives. And so, therefore, prior to these words, Paul is actually writing about the faith of Abraham, and he's bringing us back to the reason of our faith and in the person of Christ. And so, therefore, since we've been made right in God's sight by faith, we have peace with God because of what Christ our Lord has done for us because of our faith. Christ has brought us into this place of highest privilege where we now stand. Boy, some of the terminology here, in the highest privilege. I don't know if that's kind of religiosity, churchianity, but some people get that way, don't we? Can get that way. Joyfully look forward to sharing God's glory. We can rejoice too when we run into problems and trials, for we know that they are good for us. Don't feel like it at the time. I'm not into those trials and tribulations and whatever people want to refer to them at. We know they're good for us because they help us to learn to endure, and endurance develops strength of character in us, and character strengthens our confident expectation of salvation. And this expectation will not disappoint us, for we know how dearly God loves us, because he has given us the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with his love. So I want to specifically focus on the verses 3 and 4. And we can rejoice too when we run into problems and trials, and that endurance develops strength of character in us. But where in any of this does it say that God gives us those problems? This is the thing, some of the things I've learned in the past have really been challenged, and I've been wrestling with these things. Where does it say, you know, and God doesn't give us, what does God give us? He gives us good gifts. He gives us good things. And so I can't go there where, you know, God gives the sickness to somebody to correct them or straighten them out, or God does this or God does that. It's just, I'll move on. So we're going to run into all those problems. We're going to run into those challenges and trials. But why? You know, we're going to hit them, but what's the result of that? We can give up. We can give up hope. A lot of people give up hope. I mean, we see people getting involved in drugs, alcohol, and all these escapes, because that's the only hope they have is an escape of some sort. But God gives us more than that. He gives us a hope where we can have a life that's different. We can turn it around. I was talking with a young man the other day that I haven't seen him in many years. And he's going through some of these struggles right now. And as we were talking yesterday, some of the things coming out of his mouth were, you know, well, I know God's giving me this to challenge me and to make me better. And I'm sitting there and I'm going, really? And he's so downcast. He's so crushed. And I'm sitting, I'm going, God didn't give this stuff to you. He's a loving father. I said, now I'm going to do a brief counseling session with you. Where did all these problems really come from? He said, well, my bad decisions. I said, there it is. But he gives us the opportunity to partner with him to get some things straightened out, doesn't he? That's where we learn that endurance. That's where we learn some of that perseverance. And we're all on this journey to ultimate restoration with God. And it's our character that's being formed and conformed into the character of Christ. And it also reveals the character of Christ through us to the world around us. And we get those opportunities. Now, was it God's will that I ended up meeting with that young man that day? Well, I don't know. Circumstances come together where sometimes you know, but I felt that nudge. So maybe, you know, I drove past him, saw him sitting outside, and I ran my errand, and I came back, and he wasn't there, but the chair was still outside, and I pulled over, and I hollered to him, and he came out. But I felt that nudge, something where hopefully I could plant that seed. Was it God's will? Oh, I think it's always God's will that we reach out in his love. Is that safe to say? But I don't think he orchestrated it. I think he used different circumstances to bring something about. And that's what we read in Romans 8:26 through 28. The Holy Spirit helps us in our distress. We don't even know what we should pray for. How many times has that happened to anybody? I don't know. But the Holy Spirit prays for us with groanings that cannot be expressed in words. But the Holy Spirit prays for us. The Holy Spirit never does anything the Father doesn't instruct the Holy Spirit to do. So who's the Holy Spirit interceding with? See, this is the mystery of the Trinity. How's it? I just can't wrap my brain around it. And, you know, I just stopped trying. It doesn't, it's a mystery, my son. And the Father knows all hearts, knows what the Spirit is saying, for the Spirit pleads for us believers in harmony with God's own will. And we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose for them. So God, in our journey, I think God just takes all these circumstances and starts plugging them in here and there. That's what blows my mind about this, that God is, he may not have his fingers in everything and orchestrating it, but he can use circumstances and situations to encourage us, listening to that nudge in our hearts, that nudge in our spirits. And, but how involved is he in everything? And where is he in the midst of all of it? There's a young man named Colton Dixon who was one of the finalists for American Idol. And he's got quite a testimony. And he sings a song called Through All of It. And I found this on YouTube. It's a powerful version where you'll see some testimonies throughout. And then we'll discuss that a little bit. This is going to be a little different. We're going to have some discussion in the middle, and then we'll have some discussion at the end too, if that's okay. If we don't go too crazy on the discussion in the middle, we'll get to the end. But let's take a look at this.
Elliot's my fourth child. Basically, when they pulled Elliot out, they knew right away that something wasn't right with him.
I was working with troubled teens in a halfway house. I'd always wanted to be a pastor, but I'd always wanted to be a cop. That following spring, I was officer of the year in 2002.
There was a tumor in my brain. What 21-year-old wants to hear they have cancer?
15 or 16, I started struggling with an eating disorder.
It was my 12th birthday. I was turning 12. None of us heard the gunshot. We just heard my mom screaming.
I was sold into sex trafficking by my mother. I was 12.
They covered me with plastic, pronounced me dead. People meet me and they would never know all the things that I've been through.
I would overexercise, skip meals, trying to keep the shell pretty. I still ran track, and every race I lost was because I wasn't skinny enough. I had that approval addiction. It took control of me.
There are days of taking more than I can give. And there are choices that I made that I wouldn't make again.
My parents had planned an intervention for me, and my family, now they're telling me that I'm hurting them. That started a turning point.
I had my share of laughter, of tears and troubled times. This has been the story of my life. I've won, and I've lost. I got it right sometimes, but sometimes I did not.
All of the lies that I had been speaking over myself and all of the pain from my past were replaced with who I am in Christ.
Life's been a journey. I've seen joy, I've seen regret. Oh, and you have been my God through all of it.
This particular pastor called and he says, we've gotten these two young men who broke into a bunch of cars. We just need you to come and pick them up.
You were there when it all came down on me.
The two young men conspired to kill me, throw me out in the woods somewhere, and take off with my car and run. So I jumped on the hood, put my gun right up against the glass, and said, don't do it. It took off with me on the hood of the car. When I jumped off of the hood, I hit the back of my head, which immediately busted both my inner ears.
In those unclear moments, you're the one keeping me strong. This is how my story's always gone. I won.
I had severe vertigo.
I lost.
Panic attacks, PTSD.
I got it right sometimes, but sometimes I did not.
Everything that I had ever taken pride in, my strength, my abilities, all of that was gone.
Life's been a journey. I've seen joy, I've seen regret.
was a really, really rough labor. He had a 9x6 centimeter cyst in the center of his brain. His head was extra large. We don't know if he'll talk. We don't know if he'll walk. My heart sunk. I had no idea that he would end up having 8 surgeries that year.
He hit me head on at 80 miles per hour. When the police got there, I was pronounced dead without a pulse for almost an hour. When they pulled the car off of me, I took a gasp. I started breathing again. When I left the hospital, I was told that I'd never be able to have children, and they're not sure if I'd be able to walk again.
I was trapped in a house with a man who abused me for 6 months.
I walked in, and he was just on the floor. I just think it's crazy walking in on your stepfather shooting himself at 12 on your birthday.
To realize that I may never perform music again, I was almost more sad about that than having cancer itself.
And this is who you are, more constant than the stars up in the sky. All these years of our lives, I look back and I see you. Right now I still do. I'm always going to.
I changed my attitude. I said, I'm going to give this to God, and I'm going to allow people into my life to help me. I can't do this alone.
I believe that God is a great physician. Even when they said I'd never have children again, I just didn't believe it. I'm walking, I'm running, and I have a child.
I've won, I've lost. I got it right sometimes, but sometimes I did not. Life's been a journey, seen joy.
That has to be because God is with me.
There's no way I could have got through all this just by myself.
I knew he was there, and as he rebuilt me, I regained all that I had lost without the arrogance.
I see how his hand has shielded me, and there's a purpose in that. Every day I'm living out that purpose.
Everyone been through a difficult time. I can do anything through Christ who strengthened me.
He's alive. Anyone who sees him thinks he's a miracle.
3 and a half.
In every situation, there can be joy, there can be life. What I thought was a death sentence turned into be my story and my life. I've battled cancer 4 times. If I trust in him, I can do anything.
Those are some pretty strong testimonies. But not everybody has a testimony like that, do we? But I think all of our struggles and all of our pain that we go through is just as important to God. Challenges. I love what that young man said. That had cancer, he's fought cancer 4 times. He said, in every situation, there can be death and there can be life. Whatever the situation, whatever the circumstances are. So let's take a moment and look at some of the responses that we run across, because there's thousands that we could probably list, but I just want to go through a couple of these. So the first one is, so there's a reason for everything. What do people mean by that statement? Well, there's a reason for everything.
I think we would like to know there. We would like to know the reason for everything. So because we desire it, that means there must be.
I think that's true. We desire, there's got to be a reason.
Why did that happen? Why did that happen the way it happened?
And then maybe we try to walk our way through a reason. Yeah?
In some ways, it sounds to me almost like you're putting blame on someone, maybe even God, or other people in your lives, or whatever.
Sherri-Ann, you were going to say something.
Sometimes in my life, people have suggested that things were happening because God was correcting me. That, you know, it was a reminder that I needed to pray more, read my Bible more, and, you know, give more, do more. And that was really discouraging.
Damaging.
Somehow I deserved the things that were happening. This week, like the first week we were gone, the transmission in our van is such that we can still drive it, but we can't haul the books. And so the solution was, well, we'll borrow our son-in-law's truck, which is just as old as our van. That happened 5 miles away from the church we were going to in New Hampshire. And we coasted in, and, you know, $4,500 to redo this and fix everything that's wrong. We were like, it's not even worth that much money at 15 or 16 years old, whatever it is. So that was a little bit crazy. And then, of course, Bandy came and brought us home. And then the next week we had to be in Chelsea right by Augusta, and we were there. Mayor came home to get the trailer Thursday night, and Mike's truck, the transmission went and won't go above second gear, and that was the last vehicle we knew of right now to get the books home. So we rented a cargo van, and we were staying in the home of a woman who she has a farmhouse. She brought the suit against the state many years ago for there to be a right for all of us to homeschool. And she is a very godly woman, and she's had many years in her faith, and she really is someone, you know, to look up to. And when Maynard called me to tell me that this is what had happened, and I just sat down at the table and I thought, oh no, you know, because we haven't found a replacement vehicle yet. She just looked at me and she said, well, this is just an opportunity to see the sovereignty of God. And that was her. And I just looked at her and I said, I know, I'm just tired of getting to prove his God. You know? And she said, well, you know, maybe there's something that you need to learn in this about his sovereignty. And I said, listen, I am so believing in his sovereignty. I don't want this lesson anymore, you know? And maybe it's just because the world's just fallen. And maybe it's because, you know, so I get the struggle to understand, like, there's got to be some big, huge, cosmic, earth-shattering God reason for the struggles we go through. I'm not sure that's true. I mean, you know, it's a fallen, messy, sinful world where there are consequences. If you continue to drive a 15-year-old vehicle and tug thousands of books, eventually the vehicle's going to wear out. So some of that is just the natural order that God has ordained. But the need for there to be some way for him to be glorified in it, for him to be lifted up, and for me to not lose track of my faith in him, I need to hold on to that reason in the middle of things. I need to hold on to, this is a small trial that feels big to me right now, but in the face of who is he and who am I, I'm going to get past this, and in a little while, it's going to be okay. I'm not a good hallway girl. I'm not good at people, so I'm not. The reason things happen, we're living. Things are going to continue to happen, but at every turn, I have an opportunity to decide to cling closer to him, trust him, and do what, you know, he's given me to be able to do. Or I can get angry with him and turn away.
So this takes us to a statement that was made in the video too. I'm going to give this to God. So do you think that maybe some people use that terminology, I'm going to give this to God, so that they can duck out of their own responsibilities? So if this life is a partnership with God, I think a statement like this can go a couple of different ways. I think it can go for, you know, well, you know what? I don't know what to do. I don't know how to handle it. I'm giving it to God and just let him deal with it. And I'm going to stick my head in the sand. Or it could be, you know what? I just need to lean on God, lean into him, listen to that nudge. Take what's mine, We used to tell the guys in our the Teen Challenge program I worked for, you know, own what's yours, and then God will partner with you and he'll bring you through the rest of it.
You asked before, how do you know? So what? So does God intervene? What? How does he intervene? And why does there seem to be variability if he does intervene in all these things? And the thought that I had was, we know that he intervenes by speaking to us. We have our personal relationship with him. And if we're listening for God's voice, and we already know how and who God wants us to be, then we become the people who intervene with God's prompting. And there's variability in that because we either struggle to hear God's voice, or we mischaracterize God and then mischaracterize how he wants us to be. Or we say, I'll give it to God and I'll do nothing, because he'll just intervene like he just has a direct line from him to the situation, ignoring that we really have a part to play in that. And that could explain some of that variability. It can also explain why we see these miraculous things happen, because, you know, I think people in my field have known for a long time, if you have good emotional health, you're tending to have good physical health, generally. And if you don't, you don't, by and large. And I think we underestimate the degree to which our own peace and contentment and faith has a natural healing effect on whatever it is that's going on with us, if we allow ourselves to partner with God in that way.
That's good.
And I think I'm going to give this to God, depends on what you believe God is. If you believe God gave you that sickness and you're saying, I'm going to give this to God, it could be in an angry, I'm giving this right back to you, thank you very much, I'm done. Yeah. Or it could be in that, I'm really done dealing with, you know, like part of what you said, Sherri-Anne, you know, why does it have to be your turn again? Can't it be someone else's turn to prove the sovereignty of God? Because it really does seem like, as I watch things, it seems that some people get lots and lots of chances to be the proof of sovereignty of God. And some people get less of those chances. And as a fairness girl, that doesn't always feel good to me, to watch some people having to do it over and over and over again, even if they are gracious about it happening and deal with it perfectly. It's like, oh man, why do they have to deal with something? They can't catch a break sideways. You know, why does that have to be their turn again? Or, you know, whatever.
A lot of unanswered questions in that. But that begs the question, the sovereignty of God, too.
I don't think it's proves the sovereignty of God. I think
how sovereign is he?
God is there the whole time.
Fingers and everything.
And how do we define it?
And how do we define it? That's the point. Going to give it to God. I'm just going to trust God. Just trust God. Again, that's another one of those that I think sometimes we just spit out terms and statements that are just simple for us to spit out and turn, you know, and do. Where's God in all of this? How's this one? I heard this one the other day. Well, he's on the throne. That one's not up there, but that's okay. He's on the throne. Okay. All right. So are these just sometimes callous statements? Gonna give this to God. I'm just gonna trust God. Do we sit back, do nothing? Sometimes, maybe. I think sometimes in order for God to move, maybe there's times when we just gotta get out of the way. Then I think there's other times we've got to engage.
How many more times do we hear people say these things than say something like, what can I do for you? What can I do to be helpful?
Right. What's the image?
Which is really like the ultimate caring for the other person. Let me serve you. What can I do for you? Do you just need to listen? Do you need me to... something I can provide for you. I mean, that's really where we our God's intervention in that.
That's an amazing point, because that's what we have a tendency to do. The church, how many times in the church, oh, I'm going through this, I'm going through that. Oh, I'm so sorry, I'll pray. When maybe it's not prayer that's needed. Well, yeah, prayer is always needed, I think, but what can I do that's tangible now?
And the people who are praying over here, then you've got the people who are intervening over here and doing things. And these people who are praying saying, all of our prayers worked. God did, you know. I mean, which is fine, but I think it's important to recognize the hands and feet on the earth that carry those things out.
Or they say, see, our prayers came up. God brought somebody along.
But let's be careful, because sometimes we don't have the skill or the finance or whatever to be the one who does. But to be agreeing with that person, you know, for a good solution and to line up our will with God's, that's always a good thing, because the more we practice that when we do have the means, we're more likely to step into it. And none of these phrases, I don't think, are terrible. Unless they stand alone, you know, they're the beginning. Like when you said that about not hitting a wall, about understanding the Trinity, but really, you know, swimming in the ocean, I thought, yeah, you know, this is the same. Yes. We can be present with someone in their trouble to many varying degrees. And it's a choice we have to make, all of us, about what's appropriate.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, let's move on. Romans 8, 26, 20 through 28 says the Holy Spirit helps us in our distress. And I'm going to jump right down to 28. We know that God causes everything to work together for good to those who love him and are called according to his purpose for them. So what do we do when just doesn't snap his fingers, like we've been talking about? Sometimes we've got to engage. God just can't snap his fingers. Other people's wills are involved. This is a journey. It's not a easy, there are no easy answers, I don't think, because every circumstance, every situation is different. Is God still moving in our lives? Sure. Maybe just not the way we expect. There's a scripture that says, well, his ways are not our ways, and his ways are higher than his thoughts are higher than our thoughts. Well, I think he can see a picture a little bit differently than the way we can. But again, I don't think he's blueprinting meticulousness and saying, well, this has got to go here and this has got to go there. You know, we've heard that terminology about, what is your destiny in God? You know, what is your purpose in God? Is it predestined? You know, are we supposed to, is there only one way to go? And I've heard, you know, I went to Bible college, they talked about the perfect will of God and the permissible will of God. I mean, that's some pretty heavy statements there that I've wrestled with for years and going, well, you know, is this permissible? All things are permissible, but maybe they're not good for me. You know, I know that scripture, and I know this scripture, and I know that scripture, but if you subscribe to, I think, to that blueprint theology, can be very challenging. I like what Walter Brueggemann said here about this verse. He said, looking at what Paul is speaking about in Romans 8, he really seems to be focusing on our future position, okay? So future position, I tend to think that predestination has more to do with where ultimately God, I'm going to be with God, in God, at the end, not necessarily that I'm going to be, you know, my destiny is to be rich and famous or anything like that.
future position in Christ and a focus on the future based upon our current circumstances. And he wants me to see that though I live in a world often with a message of futility, I have assurance of the future and the hope of my future position with God for all eternity. Paul lets them know that because they have this indwelling of the Spirit, that the Spirit will carry them through their prayers and speak to them in ways that are hard to verbalize, hearkening back to that scripture that says the Spirit will intercede for us in unspeakable ways in those moanings and groanings. So I think we could be pretty sure that God's trying to work something out. And we may not know it then, we may not know it after, we may not know it for many days, maybe even many years, what God's working out. But I think he's, as we partner with him, we can begin to see his hand in different ways that get us to the point where we're saying, you know, I could not have done that on my own, or I've never done that before. Well, where did you get the thought process from that? Did God work some things together? How did we do that? We reach out to him, we pray. And it seems to me he just partners with us through all of our circumstances. We make the choices. And I like how Jessica Kelly says it. She says, I believe there's an infinite number of choices and God has an infinite number of directions. That's a powerful statement because I always saw it like a tree, you know, it comes up, I make my decision, and then off of that decision, there's an innumerable ways that it can be, you know, affected or what's going to happen because there's so many different people, those variables that you talked about, Maynard. And then, you know, okay, fine, I'm going to make my decision off of this, and then it branches off again. And then another decision I make and it branches off again. And there's an infinite number of ways that I think we can go and end up. But God, I think through it all, God still, as long as we're engaging God, if we're partnering with him, I think that's the key. Is that, you know, we're keeping that connection. Does that make sense?
Yes.
I like what, and Brueggemann goes on and he says, I think the danger sometimes is that we as humans are decided what are the all things that he's working together for our good. And then we are also defining what is meant by good. I think I need to be careful taking two bad things and then praying this verse and thinking those two bad things will result in a good thing. I love Walter. He lays it right out there. We have to be careful. You know, it's going back to that blueprint theology. Well, you know, if God's so in charge, then why does this, and this happen? And I think that's the direction where a lot of atheists go is, you know, with all the things in the world that happen, how can God allow this? God can't go against man's will. He won't go against man's will. So it's God's character, and Jessica says this. It gives us hope to survive. This blueprint theology gives us hope to survive, but no passion. And she says the passion is what's missing. Hope is about surviving, but passion is about God's character. That's a powerful statement. You know, I can just hope and I can meander through this life, or I can really enjoy this life and have some passion in following God. There may be things that he's doing that we don't understand. Banning Liebscher, he's the founder and pastor of Jesus Culture. This is an excerpt from his sermon, Rooted, that you can look at online. He says towards the end of it, he says, I'm convinced that when we can really see what God is doing, he's there through all of it, like this song, then you can really understand the process that he is developing your life with. Then you will have a fresh appreciation for what he's doing. And you won't resist or fight or try to rush the process. And that he's actually written a book called Rooted, The Hidden Places Where God Develops You. So I think in that process with God, he's working those things out. But that predestination, is he bringing us to our destiny? Is there a perfect will of God? How have we seen him partner with us?